comes to this thing. Well, good morning, everyone. It's a joy to be here. What a testimony of God's faithfulness there we just heard from Abby out at Elgin. I don't know about you, but I was moved between the worship and a testimony. And now we get the pleasure of God's word. And by his grace, we'll get through this before noon. I know it's hot in here, but, you know, no one's hotter right now than me. I can promise you that. All right? So if I can deal with it, y'all can deal with it. All right. We have been working through the book of Ephesians. Ephesians. Dr. Radelnik has graciously brought us this far, all the way up to the end of chapter 2. And as I open my Bibles, you guys can open your Bibles as well to the book of Ephesians. We have gotten through chapter 2. We are now beginning in chapter 3. Our text today is going to be chapter 3, verses 1 through 13. And as Dr. Radelnik outlined for us, the book is set up in a way that makes sense. Chapters 1 through 3 are wealth. Chapters 4 and 5 are our work. And chapter 6 is our warfare passage. Or as I like to say, chapters 1 through 3 is truth. 4 and 5 is our time to obey. And chapter 6 is our time to pray. So we are going to be finishing our section of truth here in chapter 3. And it's a glorious truth in the gospel this morning. A glorious truth of a mystery that has been revealed. As Dr. Adelnis left us in the scope of our wealth, he left us with chapter 2, verses 1 through 10, where we explore the riches of regeneration. This is a regenerate heart by God's grace. He says in verse 4, rich in mercy because of the love that he had for us. And then in chapter 2, verses 11 through 21, which leads us right into chapter 3, we see the richness of reconciliation. Reconciliation of races, of Jewish Israel versus Gentile and all the other nations. And today we're going to unpack this mystery. Actually, today unpacks a little bit more of the mystery that started to get revealed in chapter 2. So let's stand and read God's word. For this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, on behalf of you Gentiles, assuming that you have heard of the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me for you, how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I have written briefly. When you read this, you can perceive my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was made known to the sons of men in other generations, as it has now been revealed to these holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. This is the mystery, that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel I was made a minister, according to the gift of God's grace, which was given to me by the working of his power. To me, though I am the very least of all of the saints, this grace was given, to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to bring to light for everyone what is the plan of the mystery, hidden for ages in God, who created all things, so that through the church, the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was according to the eternal purpose that he has realized in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through faith in him. So I ask you not to lose heart over what I am suffering for you, which is your glory. This is the word of the God. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Please be seated and let's pray. Father in heaven, as we dive into this passage, remind us that while Paul penned these words, they are your words. They are words inspired by your Holy Spirit. Cultivate the word that was written by the Spirit, by the same Spirit that lives in us now, Lord, that we may hear and have eyes to see what it is that you have for us in this teaching today. Give grace to me as I deliver as your messenger, humbly, in Jesus' name, amen. Well, we had a little situation in our house this week, and I hesitate to actually bring you into the confidence of my home personal household, especially in matters of between Kim and I. I think I should. Don't you think, honey? Is it okay? No, it's not okay. We had a small situation this week. Kim, I learned this, is actually a magician. I didn't know it. She's a magician, and she showed a magic trick to Blake, and my youngest, and to me. And the first, I'd never seen this magic trick before. I didn't even know she could do magic tricks. I had actually known Blake to do magic tricks, but I didn't know that, you know, the son picks up from the mother. I thought it came from the father, and I don't do magic. So when I get to see magic, I want to see it. I want to understand it. I want to know it. Well, Kim shows us a magic trick, and Blake is very astute. He's studying, and I'm just sort of like, oh, that was amazing. Tell me how you did it. And she said, no. No? What do you mean? Share with me what it is that you did. How is that possible that this was this and it looked like that and then that didn't happen and it defied gravity? I'm like, I want to know. I want to know what this is. I want to see what it is that you did. Reveal it to me. And she said, no, a magician never reveals his secrets, her secrets in this case. And I was mad. I was mad. It wasn't great in our house for a little while. You could sense tension in the air. You could see it. You could cut through the knife. Well, within a matter of maybe 5 or 8 minutes, Blake had, by this power of the Spirit, thankfully he's going to bring his mother and father back together. He was so observant in this magic trick that he actually learned it really fast. And this is what happened.
All right, we're coming in. Hey, Blake, show Ashley that cool magic trick that we were doing.
Okay, so you have the cloth, nothing here. You put it down, fold it once, fold it twice, fold it a third time. Then you have nothing here. Take the toothpick and put it wherever you would like.
Ooh, good spot.
Perfect. So now it's in here, and then when you go, you hear a snap.
I heard it crack, yeah. What? It's still whole?
And then when you open it up, nothing's
what?
Inside.
That's amazing.
That's amazing.
It's amazing. All right, man. I want to know how you did that because I want to show someone else.
Okay. So it's a little weird, but you would think it's actually in the corner.
Oh, there's another toothpick. It's all in the setup. There's the half. Oh, man.
I tricked you.
You did. Thanks for showing us, Blake.
You're welcome.
The best part about that is that you're welcome at the end. He's so polite. I love him so much. He's the best. He's the best. Well, contrary to magic, we're going to uncover mystery today. We're going to uncover biblical mystery today. And even as Kim and Blake set that trick up, God sets up his mystery as well. So we're going to dive deep a little bit into this. This is actually quite a bit of a difficult passage to go through as we were preparing for it with the help of Dr. V, who is our guest tonight. Where is he? In the back there? There he is, yeah. He told us, I'm so glad I'm not preaching this. And I'm like, thanks, man. that's awesome. He goes, no, the last time I preached it took me 3 full sermons to get through these 13 verses. So, oh, great. That's even better. You're really putting it on for me. Thanks so much. Well, we are going to dive in, and it is going to get a little heavy, so let's get into it today. Biblical mystery it's something that humankind cannot and would not know unless God revealed it. And so specifically in the context of Ephesians 3, mystery is a theological and spiritual truth that's hidden by God. And it's not manifested until the proper time. Prophecy fulfilled, for our context, would not be considered mystery revealed because it was foreknown, and then there were people that were expecting it and waiting. This is new mystery. This is a new thing that is being revealed. Jesus spoke in parables in order to keep secret the mysteries of the kingdom that he had come and that will come later. And so he spoke in parables because he had known that some would not be ready to receive what it is that he had. And those were the Jewish people at the time. They rejected his messiahship. And so he revealed only to those that had eyes that were open and ears to hear, which is why I said that at the end of reading of the text. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Because those are the words that Jesus ascribed even to his disciples. Listen to this in Matthew 13, verse 11 and 16. And he answered them. The question was, why do you speak in parables? To you it has been given to know the secrets of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it has not been given. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. For truly I say to you, many prophets and righteous people longed to see what you see and did not see it, and to hear what you hear and did not hear it. So today we are seeing and hearing the things that the prophets of old longed to hear, longed to know. And it is now revealed for us in the new covenant, in the New Testament, 2,000 years after Christ. And it just means that we are so much more, we have such a bigger requirement now with this knowledge that we have to take out into the world. We're going to unpack that a lot today. So we're in this mystery kingdom at this point in time. Matthew 13 lays out 9 different parables that reveal little bits of the outworkings of the mystery kingdom. That mystery kingdom began when Israel rejected Jesus' messiahship. And it won't end until Israel, the remnant of Israel, accepts Jesus as Messiah. And that will happen in the millennium. And so we're in the mystery kingdom now. All of us are in this kingdom, this mysterious kingdom today. So how much more important is it that we have that revealed to us? Are there any Jewish people here today? Go ahead. Participation in church. No Jewish people in our audience. Are there any Greek people here today? If George, George, he's in Miami, so we'll raise his hand for him. So everyone else would be considered of the nations or a Gentile. And that's where we come in. This is part of the mystery being revealed. Paul wrote in Romans 11:11, so I ask, did they stumble, they meaning Israel, in order that they may fall? By no means. Rather, through their trespass, salvation has come to the Gentiles so as to make Israel jealous. We've been given a gift as Gentiles. All of us in here fit that description because none of us are Jewish. None of us are of the nation of Israel. So let's dive in. We've got a bit of things to unpack here. We're going to start right in chapter 3, verse 1, right where we should. A little just bit of literary context. So what you see here, if you've got your Bible laid out like mine, it might show chapter 3, verse 1 on one side and verse 14 on the other. You're going to notice a similarity in the beginning of verse 1 and the beginning of verse 14. They both start with, for this reason. For this reason, I, even. And in chapter 1, we see Paul getting ready to pray a prayer of spiritual strength. He's getting ready to actually pray and start in verse 14 because he just finished explaining the gospel to a church that was full of a mix of people from all nations. And he says, now you're going to be under the household of God. You who are alienated from Christ, you who didn't have a promise, you didn't have a covenant, you didn't even have a God. And now you have a God. And you've been grafted in. And so once the outworkings of all this are starting to come to fruition, a whole household is being built on the foundation that the apostles and the prophets shared, the cornerstone being Jesus Christ. Do you see the word choices in here? Structure, dwellings, temple, being built together in a dwelling place for God. This is going to take strength, but not physical lifting strength, spiritual strength, to merge what was so separate into one. And he's about to call and ask the Lord through the Spirit for that spiritual prayer. But just as he's about to do that, he digresses to make sure that the people actually fully understand what it is that's going on here as he left verse 2. So the digression goes from, well, he starts there. I'm a prisoner on behalf of you Gentiles. So this is literal. He's literally a prisoner. He's in prison writing this. Not some spiritual version of being a prisoner under Christ. Oh, I'm captive, you know, I'm going to do whatever. No, he's in prison. And he's in prison because he's been preaching the gospel to the Gentiles and the world doesn't like it. So he's been stoned, he's been hungry, he's been shipwrecked. He's now in prison writing this letter. He's in prison. He wrote a number of letters there. But that's not to get the people into a state of sorrow. It's to share with them, look, the Lord is still working on you through me. And so it's okay that I'm in prison. Yes, I am a prisoner, but it's on your behalf that I am this prisoner. It's good for you that I'm here. That's what he's actually trying to convey. It's good for you that I'm here, assuming, as we move into verse 2, that you've heard of the stewardship of God's grace. Stewardship of God's grace. Now, if you have an ESV Bible, your Bible says stewardship. If you have an NIV Bible, it says administration. If you have the NRSV, it says commission. And if you're old school and you have the KJV, it says dispensation. Tom probably has dispensation, I'm guessing, as I look at him. Well, Bible students sometimes use the term dispensation for here. We've got to just take a pause and actually unpack this word just a little bit, because it does set the tone of what Paul's actually digressing into before he goes into prayer. And so it's somewhat important. So Bible students use this word dispensation. It really means, you know, a revelation. God dispenses his revelation over time at certain points according to his will. And it doesn't mean that he's changing his mind. It just means that he's got a master plan, and it's time to unveil this part of the plan. The time in history, and all of you people are right, this plan is going to get unveiled. Some time will progress, this plan in history is going to get unveiled. But it's all under the scope of an eternal master plan, as we saw reading in verse 11 from our text today. Well, the Greek word here, stewardship, is oikonomia. It's two words blended together, oikos and nomi, which is sort of house law, is how it literally would be translated. But it carries with this obligation of responsibility to manage someone else's property as if you're a servant. And so that's why we get stewardship from it. We use the word stewardship from it. We also get the word, this English word, economy, from it. And some of you know that I'm actually a former student of the economy. I've been in the world of finance for a while and economics, and before, you know, becoming a pastor here. And when you're a student of economics and when you're a student of finance and kind of the marketplace, you learn one of the most important economic principles, economic laws or principles out there in the area of productivity. And what you learn is a foundational principle of economic law is that if you want to increase productivity, you need to put to use the highest and best use of a certain instrument or of a certain tool. In some of our companies that I advise or manage, we in the manufacturing in the Midwest, we see constantly people replacing labor with computerized machines, CNC machines that are out there. Well, why is that happening? They're more efficient. There's less waste. They can work 24 hours. You don't have to feed them. You don't have to pay them. You just have to plug them in. We can repurpose the people that were doing the cutting to run the machine so we don't lose jobs, but the entire operation gets far more efficient. Why? Because of the tool. Because it was the proper instrument put in the proper place. And this is what Paul is referring to about himself. Let's go back to Acts 9. You can turn there if you'd like. Acts 9, verse 15. Those of you that know your Bible will know that this is where Paul's conversion happens. But it's important to look at the text because we're picking up on some words that are prevalent through the Bible. Verse 15 says, "But the Lord said to him, 'Go, for he is a chosen instrument of mine to carry my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel, for I will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name.'" Well, let's pick a few things up from this as well. Jesus chose Paul. Paul didn't choose Jesus. Jesus chose Paul. Jesus, the master and commander of his entire global operation, decides the tools that he's going to use in production for the kingdom. And he chose Paul. And Paul, in a dramatic way, agrees. "I'm obedient." Not only that, in other parts of Scripture, he's compelled. I was watching Abby's testimony just now. Do you think she's compelled in a new way to do things for the Lord that she could never have been in her old life? Do you see the power of the gospel come to work in people's lives when we show videos like this or in testimonies we share amongst ourselves? The "I was, but what God did, and now"? Paul's speaking from the "and now" after he's been given the full commission. And there's humility in that. And that humility is going to allow him to handle the suffering that lies ahead. Abby's chosen. It may feel like it's all roses on that video, but she's headed into, because she's picked aside, the enemy's going to come after that family. The enemy's going to come after her. She needs to be prayed up. She might have to have some suffering that goes on in her life, but that's okay, because God's with her. God's not done with her yet, right? We sing that song. God's not done with Paul yet. That's what he's professing here to the church in Ephesus. All right, chapter 3, verses 4 and 5. We got to unpack that just a little bit because this is really important to understand. When you read this, you can perceive my insight into the mystery of Christ. You can perceive it because if you're in Christ and I'm in Christ, we're actually being compelled by the same Spirit, which was not made known to the sons of men in other generations as it has been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. Okay, we're going to just take a second here. We've got to jump over back to Acts. So if you're still in Acts 9, stay there, flip a page to Acts 10. Because Paul's actually talking about an event that actually happened, and you can see it in Acts 10. Acts 10, Acts 11, and even in Acts 15. We're just going to take a second because we have to really understand to see that Paul's actually referring to certain things when he says it's been revealed by the holy apostles and the prophets by the Spirit. We're in Acts 10. This is Peter's vision. Paul's just had his tremendous conversion. He's in Damascus. So these are actually in somewhat parallel tracks. Peter's vision comes to him, and we probably are familiar with this. He's in a trance. We've got the big blanket and the whole four corners, and God says, what God has made clean, do not call common, over in verse 15. But this applies in verse 28. And he said to them, this is Peter talking, you yourselves know how unlawful it is for a Jew to associate with or to visit anyone or any other nation. Obviously bound by the Torah at this point. But he's in the house of Cornelius, a Gentile. But God has shown me that I should not call any person common or unclean. It started in the dietary laws, started with the food, but God's breaking down these laws and applying them to the people. Because by the blood of Christ, no one is common anymore. And he's revealing that to Peter right here. And this is quite traumatic. Cornelius' family is saved. He hears the good news for the first time. You can see that in verses 34, God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. These walls are being broken down between Jew and Gentile, and the apostles and the prophets are bringing that in now. This didn't happen in other areas of the Old Testament. This is all new, and the apostles are like wrestling with this. What is going on here? This was not foretold. And here it is. You can see it. In verse 44, flip over to there. When the Holy Spirit falls on the Gentiles, while Peter was saying these things, the Holy Spirit fell on all who heard the word. And the believers from whom the circumcised had come with Peter, these are Jews with Peter, were amazed because the gift of the Holy Spirit was poured out even on the Gentiles. The same thing that happened in Acts 2, the Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit was dispersed and people were speaking in tongues. Thousands of people were saved in that beginning of the early church who were all Jewish. And now that same gift has been revealed to go to the Gentiles. This is what Paul's referring to in our passage today. It's been revealed. It was revealed to Peter. It was revealed to those that were with Peter. It was then revealed to all of the apostles at the Jerusalem Council over in Acts 15, of which Paul was a small but not insignificant part of, but primarily Peter and James presided over the fact that this first ecumenical kind of council that gathers together to agree and understand that by the power of the Spirit, by the wisdom that was given them through discernment of the Spirit, they can now see plainly that Gentiles have access to salvation. The prophets sure helped. As James just brings forth, he speaks of Amos's prophecy, the remnant of mankind may seek the Lord, that all the Gentiles who are called by my name. So James is amazing at this point. He grabs some of the Old Testament prophecy that the nations will all be saved, Gentiles included, and he brings it in with this new revelation of the Holy Spirit being poured out on Gentiles. And he adds those together, and Gentiles are now part of the church, of which Paul has the job, the commission, the stewardship to go and convey, which of course is in keeping with Acts 1. Right? When Jesus says, I'm bestowing the Holy Spirit on you so that you can profess my name to Jerusalem, to Judea, to the Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Well, those first three got handled by the apostles. And God used the stoning of Stephen to disperse people into Samaria. And then Paul comes on the scene later. We're going to pick that up later when he talks about being the least of these. But he's by no means the least of these. I'm sure he feels that way. So we see how Christ is revealing the mysteries. He's revealing it through the apostles. He's revealing it by the Spirit. The evidence of the Spirit is showing that. So do we see the richness of this revelation that we now have? We get the benefit of this book. The church in Ephesus got the benefit of Paul's letter to look back at what was happening. They also had the experience of which Paul was with them for years in the church. But today we have this gospel more fully confirmed because we have the whole Bible. We even have Revelation where we see how things are going to go forward from here. Friends, we're pretty much out of excuses that we can't say when we stand before the Lord on our day that we didn't know. I told you, it's right here. If we don't open this book, that's on us. We have to open our Bible. It goes together. We just pieced together a few things from a letter to a church that was 10, 12 years later from the actual events in Acts. But they go together. We're going to go back into the Gospels in a little bit and unpack what Jesus said because we have a different, we have a more full understanding of the revelation that Jesus was trying to say when he walked the earth, but it wasn't time for that to be revealed yet. So when we go back and look at Jesus' high priestly prayer, we're going to see a whole different way of looking at what Jesus was talking about. This is the richness of revelation, and we have to share it. Even you can share it. Even I can share it. Anyone in here can share it. You don't need a seminary degree to share it. Abby shared her testimony, and she professed Christ as Savior. Even the least of these can profess it. Share the gospel. If God's given you eyes to see and ears to hear his word today or in the past, tell someone. If they have eyes to hear and ears to see, they will affirm what you're saying and you will rejoice together in the glory and the riches of God. And if they don't have it, you'll come to their level and you'll understand where they are and try and lead them that way. Either way, there's work to be done when you profess Christ as Savior, when you profess the gospel. So Christ reveals the mystery. That was point one. And I know it was a little long, but the other ones are going to go just as long. My wife is sighing over here like, really? It's hot in here. I know. We're going to get through this together. It's going to be great. Together we can do this. Okay, chapter 3, verse 6. Christ unites with the mystery. Many will come into his family. Many will come into his rich family, his wealthy family. Many are going to come. The mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise in Christ through the gospel. That's what verse 6 is. Let's just stop right here. We have to understand what the mystery is, what it is and what it's not. We need absolute clarity on this. The mystery is not that salvation was going to come to the Gentiles. That was foretold. That was known. The Old Testament makes reference to this. Isaiah 11:10, Isaiah 63, Jeremiah 16:19, Micah 4:2, Zechariah 2:11 are just to name a few where all the nations would know the Lord, not just Israel. But there has never been a vision of a united community of all of those people on equal footing. So then what is the mystery? The mystery is the equal incorporation of the diversity of nations into the union of Christ. We don't lose or give up our identity and our nationality when we come into Christ. All of the joyfulness of that diversity comes together in one unifying body, which is in Jesus Christ, the Messiah. That's why Paul constantly refers to the body of the church as the body of Christ. And we all have different things that we're good at, hand and eyes and feet and toes. These are a great metaphor for all the different workings. That happens in this church. Some of you are great at greeting. Some of you are great at serving behind the scenes. But we're working together as one body to move the church forward to show and profess the love of Christ. Evidence that the mystery is revealed. We touched on this. Paul touched on this right there. By the Spirit. Romans 8:16-17. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ. provided we suffer, there's that suffering thing again, with him in order that we may be glorified with him. All right, verse 6 has three things that tell us a little bit more about the mystery and then unpack that a little bit. Our fellow heirs, our inheritance. We were not a people, and now we are a people. We Gentiles had no God. Everyone in here was born in their natural state, in a state of wrath before the Lord. I know that's kind of faux pas these days. God is love. If you listen too much to K-Love, I love K-Love, but if you listen to too much of it, you can forget that God is equal parts love and severity. And we were already there. That's what we've been rescued from. In his other letter to the Galatians, which is, by the way, so many parallels. If this passage pricks something in you, go read Galatians and Colossians and study side by side these letters. They affirm each other. But now that faith has come, we are no longer under a guardian. For in Christ Jesus, you are sons of God through faith. For as many as you were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. And if you are Christ's, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. And again, he says in chapter 4 of Galatians, and because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts so that we cry, Abba, Father. You did not cry, Abba, Father, before you were saved. Today, you know who your Father is, and the Spirit works in your heart and has softened you to fall on your knees when you are in need to call out to your Holy Father in heaven. That is only possible by the fact that we have the Spirit in us and that we are now heirs with our brothers in Israel. We've been put on, we've been baptized, we've become sons. Well, what are we inheriting? Well, we're inheriting eternal life. Praise the Lord. That is what's to come. We have spiritual blessings that are before us, even now. We have a right relationship with the Lord we didn't have before. We get our prayers heard and answered by a holy Father in heaven. But we walk alongside our brothers of Israel. We don't take those things over. And we have a conscience now that bears witness with the Spirit, who is also God, to live in a holy, loving way, even as our Father was holy, because we are a set apart people now. Part 2, we are a member of the same body. We have a new identity in Christ. Okay, this is going to get a little bit hard right here. For everyone. We're going to talk about identities. Abby is the one that started this conversation tonight, so I blame her. But in her testimony, she was seeking an identity before she knew the Lord. She was trying to find it in men. She was lost. She did not know where her identity was. Woman, human being, what else? Maybe white, maybe Republican or Democrat. What's her identity? Where is this identity that we keep seeking? That's the beauty of being one in the same body. We are all diverse, but we are unified in Christ. Anyone else think of any other thing that emulates? The Trinity. Paul Hebert, one of the professors right over here at Trinity, actually, writes about a lot of books on this. So does our own Dr. Kilner. I encourage you to read their stuff. Unity in the body of Christ does not rest in uniformity, but in the common blood that Christians have in Christ. You hear this term all the time, the ground is leveled, foot of the cross. What is that actually saying? It's saying that someone like my brother Niaz over here, who's a Syrian, right? And when I texted him in preparation for this message, I said, brother, what color skin do you actually assimilate to? And he said, Asian brown. And I'm like, I don't even know what that is. That's not a category, is it? Wait, maybe it is. God love you. It is. But why are we in small group together? Why do we love the Lord together? We had such diverse backgrounds. There is no way on this earth alone without the Lord's infusion of the Spirit in you and in me that we would be brothers in Christ and in a small group together going through life together. It's not possible. That is what the church is. That's why there's so much diversity in here, and we are to celebrate that. We're going to touch more on that as we dive into this passage. We're going to start right now. Here's a chart from Dr. Hebert. So we're going to look at levels of humanity, of human identity that are in the world and in Christ. And the arrow signifies the depth of your level of identity. The bottom being a baseline. The top being superficial. The top being the first to go. If your identities collide in a social setting, you will default to the one beneath the other one that's up there. You could probably throw in our day of turmoil, Republican and Democrat. Probably right above the bottom one. Maybe even as a baseline in America these days. It's moving with time. And the enemy is constantly putting new baselines underneath which we're supposed to identify with. So let me give you a quick example. Let's say a family, a white suburban family, has a young man. They want to see him get married. And they display their wishes to their son to go find a woman, which I know is hard to say in this day and age, but go find a woman who's white, and we don't care if she's Christian or non-Christian. What have they just done? They've elevated one identity over the other. They've said female and race matter in our family. Christ does not. That's not awesome. That's in the world. That's how the world speaks. Okay, flip that over. This is what Christ says. Christ takes that same conversation in that white suburban family and said, we don't care who you marry as long as she's a Christian, as long as she believes the same thing you believe, as long as she follows Christ, as long as she's given herself to Christ, as long as she shares in the same spirit, the same unity that you have, that we have. Because I know that there's nothing, if I'm talking to my son at that point, that the enemy of the world can overthrow when we have the foundation of Jesus Christ. Everything above that line becomes joyful to celebrate. I can celebrate with anyone of a different nation if we're in Christ together. Not only that, I look forward to it. How awesome is it to go over to Israel or go, you can put that picture up of my brother in Israel. How awesome is it to go over to Israel and find someone? 2018, we're on the Israel tour. Dr. V presiding on that tour, by the way. Thank you very much for your wisdom there. But we're in there. We actually bought a cool nativity scene made out of olive wood. And this guy, like, finding Christians in Israel isn't all as easy as you might think. But we found a store. We were led into a store where these are Messianic believers. And before they were like, hey, come shop, and we wanted a patron of Messianic church, these guys shared the gospel with us. And we had time of community together, prayer and worship to a holy God before we then bought some stuff. They cared less about that. But we ended up buying it. Maybe the Spirit was working on us. But I was so enamored at that very moment that God could bring a guy from Wisconsin, a white farm boy, together in Israel with an older gentleman who's clearly Jewish and not of the upbringing, and we're singing songs to the Lord together in a foreign country. In English, praise the Lord, that I couldn't sing it in Hebrew, but I wanted to. And I think they did, actually, at that point. I actually took this picture and I sent it to my Messianic pastor in Salt Lake City, of all places. Tell me that's the Lord's not working there. Messianic. we could go on. This is a good example, though. This is a good example of what Jesus was talking about. I told you we'd go back to the Gospels, and we should do that. Let's go see what Jesus said in John 17. You can turn your Bibles there. We're going to be in verse 22. We'll have a brief stop here before we move on. Starting in verse 22, Jesus is praying, calling out to the Lord. You know the setting before his death. He prays, the glory that you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one, even as we are one. I in them, you in me, that they may become perfectly one, so that the world may know that you sent me and love them even as you loved me. Does that scripture not come alive in the face of the church being called to be unified in one body as in Christ? This was what he prayed. There's no doubt that those apostles, if they overheard that, were like, what is he praying? This cannot possibly make sense. But it makes sense to us because the revelation's been more fully revealed. Praise the Lord through that. I pray that next time we read John 17, we're not ever thinking of it like we used to think of it, that we think about it in perfect unity with our brothers, and that the Spirit convicts us when we're at odds with a brother, that we seek unity, we seek reconciliation, we seek it in a loving way. Unity of the body, unity of the church in the body of Christ is not a result of the gospel. It is essential to the gospel. I can't stand up here and preach Christ crucified to you if none of us do it. That's why the book of James was so important. Be doers of the word, not just hearers. We have to live it as a church, that this place becomes a refuge from the world where all are welcome to hear the gospel. Let Jesus sort it out later. And he will. There is a day when the wheat and the tares get separated, the sheep and the goats get separated. We can do that here. How different would the world be if the church was a place for refugees who are tired of battling their sexual identity and keeping up on the latest LGBTQT+, whatever. Rest in Christ. That's your new identity. Or racism. What's happening in our streets every time somebody gets shot? Come to church. Find Jesus. Rest in Christ. Lay down that burden. Or if you're on MSNBC, CNN, or Fox News all the time, and you get stirred up over what one side says about the other, and this guy's lying, and that, this, and the other thing. That's a burden. I can't watch the political news anymore. It's too painful. It's like watching a train wreck. People dying left and right. It's horrible. I'd much rather read my Bible. And I don't just say that because I'm the guy up here pastoring you guys, but it's because it's in my heart. You can't watch that stuff. Maybe just enough to know, be dangerous enough to know that there's still pain in the world and that a Republican or a Democratic president's not going to fix the pain that people are feeling in the world. That's the church's job. That's Christ crucified. You can tell why this is a little bit hard to deliver sometimes in a world such as this. Pastor Jeff, when he gets here, I'm sure has many experiences in dealing with this because the Canadians are far further along than we even are. They find our God oppressive. We still fight against the fact that God exists in relativism. They've moved on from that. We are partakers of the promise. I'm going to try and move a little more quickly now. I'm sorry. Partakers of the promise. We are not overtakers of the promise. We are coming alongside our brethren, our Israeli brethren, to join with them in the spiritual blessings of this promise of salvation. God has a chosen people. He shows no partiality. We read that. It now includes us. Let's rejoice in that. God reveals the mystery. God unites in the mystery. And our final point is God provides purpose in the mystery. The church must use this wealth of knowledge and of unity for its eternal purposes. Paul was made a minister of this. We're going to be in verse 7. We're going to land the plane here at verse 13 in short order. Paul was made a minister of this gospel according to the gift of God's grace, which was given me by the work of his power. To me, though I am the very least of all the saints, was grace given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. I can empathize with Paul here. Who am I to be standing before you with God's word? I'm nobody. That did not happen in run through. I am the least of these. That's what Paul's saying here. Who am I to deliver this? Who is Abby to get up on that screen and deliver to you what God has done? She's sharing in the unsearchable riches of Christ. She's bringing light to everyone by her testimony. And we're unpacking the plan of this mystery before you today that you can take it further. There's a so that right here in verse 10. There's a reason for this. There's a purpose for this. That through the church, we're the vessel. The manifold wisdom of God might be made known, not just to us, although we see it, but to the rulers and the authorities in the heavenly places. These are angels that are now understanding this revelation for the first time when it actually happens. Good angels and bad angels, I might add. The wisdom of the Lord, of our God, of Yahweh, is now made manifest. The manifold wisdom, multi-sided, often used to describe colorful paintings or pictures some way. The manifold wisdom of God. It's made known, not just to us, but it's made known to these supernatural beings who had no idea, but now they know. At the resurrection of Jesus Christ, aha, I get it now. That's amazing, Lord. You had an eternal purpose. Nothing was ever out of your control. It was always under according to your plan. No plan B across all these covenants between the Old and the New Testament. His eternal purpose is realized in Christ Jesus from the book of Genesis through Revelation. And now we have boldness and we have the ability to access Christ. We didn't have that before. You see the contrast between earlier in chapter 2 and now? We have access through our confidence because of our faith in Jesus Christ. And as Paul ends this, he says, don't lose heart. Don't lose heart over what I'm suffering for you, which is your glory. That's a bit of a curious statement, which is your glory. Your glory, the church. We touched on it in the beginning because he's still a prisoner. He's just a commoner. He's views himself as a nobody, the least of all the apostles. He was late to the game. He only affirmed what Peter and James were already going to do by Acts 15. He is the least of these, but he's still doing the being obedient to the commission that he was given. And he's suffering for it, for their glory. And he's finding joy in the suffering. He's finding joy in that suffering because as he views his church as brothers and children in Christ, they're growing in Christ. They're being affirmed in this new revelation. And it gives them glory to be mature in Christ. The more we know about the Lord, the more we have to share it. There's glory in that. It brings glory to the Lord. And it brings glory upon ourselves. Okay, as we close, we have one more scripture that we've got to look at. And this didn't, I threatened to not actually talk about this, but I just can't resist the continuity of our holy God from the beginning of the book of Genesis all the way through to now. And if our worship team is within earshot, that'd be awesome. Hi, Jordan. Thanks. We're going to be in Genesis 11. We're just going to look at two verses super fast. And then we're going to sing and go enjoy this beautiful day. If you want to turn to Genesis 11, please do. Verse 6. This is the familiar story of the Tower of Babel. Early on in the book of Genesis. And the Lord said, behold, they are one people. And they have all one language. And this is only the beginning of what they will do. And nothing that they propose to do will now be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and confuse their language so that they may not understand one another's speech. And the Lord dispersed them. put what we've learned today against that very scripture from the beginning. The knowledge of the Lord and his truth regarding his image bearers. When one people unite, nothing they propose to do will be impossible for them. He created us this way. In the context of this passage, that oneness was used sinfully. It was evil that they were, what they were doing, what they were building. Humanity was in sin and in its flesh, and that unity was evil and for selfish purposes. But God now reveals a way for his created image bearers to unite in a new body that is Christ, so that this same oneness can be our asset to use for good. That nothing that we propose to do as a one unified church would be too impossible. That's how he created us. He dispersed them. In the context here, God reveals a way for his created image to be united in Christ, set apart, sanctified, all the faces of the earth, they were scattered. But God's not done with the human race at that very point. He creates one nation, which we know as Israel. Out of the scattered nations, he formed one nation, a chosen people, to show his beloved faithfulness through all of history. If you want a testament to the fact that God actually exists, it's the fact that Israel is still a nation today from that very point, while all other ancient nations are gone. They've intermarried and are gone, yet Israel is pure, and she stays today with us. God's with that. He's not done with that. He's not done with his church. He's not done with us. He's not done showing the rulers and the authorities of the heavenly places that the gates of hell will not prevail against his church. He's not done with me. He's not done with you. He's not done with any of us. He's uniting us by his Spirit as one people so that nothing would be impossible for his church if we're truly united. He's not done showing the world that is eternal in his eternal purpose. It's Jesus Christ, our Lord, who provides access with confidence to the Father. That's our identity. He's not done making us new in that identity. God's not done yet, and neither are we. Let's make him known.